It was a Friday evening when I sat down to write this video. In the background, I had turned on MLB Network to fill the silence. Clayton Kershaw was pitching. I love to watch Kershaw pitch. Even past his prime, there is a grace to his delivery, and just something about that looping 12-6 curveball that leaves me speechless every time I see it. On this particular evening, Kershaw was struggling, having labored through 3 1/3 difficult innings. But that didn't matter, because as I sat there, watching the best pitcher of his generation being pulled from a spring training game in the top of the fourth, my mind wandered back to this time last year. Baseball is cyclical in nature. Every spring, the season begins, filled with hope and optimism for the future. And every autumn, the season ends, only to be reborn again, without fail, after a long winter's rest. But last year, when the entire world came to a halt, it brought baseball along with it. Thankfully, baseball would return that summer, and looking back, it seems inevitable. Of course baseball came back. It had to. But for 3 long months, not a soul knew when, or even if, it would come back, and if it did, whether it would be recognizable as the game we knew. Today, as we stand on the precipice of a brand new season, I'd like to take a moment to remember the last time baseball was put on hold, a time when fans of the sport didn't know if their beloved game would even survive. On February 7th, 1995, President Bill Clinton entered the White House press room with solemn news. Despite his efforts, he had failed to broker an agreement between the MLB Players Association and the owners to end the ongoing work stoppage. The 1995 baseball season was a no-go. Nearly 6 months earlier, with labor negotiations stalling and tensions heightening, the players had gone ahead with their threat to walk off the job, going on strike August 12, 1994. It was a decision months in the making, and its impact would be felt decades after. The seeds of the strike had been planted long before it actually occurred, following rulings that they had colluded to suppress players' salaries and free agent movement. The MLB owners had been forced to pay out $393 million in damages and penalties, and they were not happy about it. They turned their ire on Commissioner Faye Vincent, forcing him out of the role in 1992 and replacing him with Milwaukee Brewers owner Bud Selig on a quote-unquote interim basis. Their new goal? Institute a salary cap. On June 14, 1994, the owners officially unveiled their proposal, which they claimed would increase average salaries from $1.2 million to $2.6 million by 2001. However, MLBPA Executive Director Donald Fair rejected the offer, stating that the salary cap was simply a way for the owners to shift the financial burden of revenue sharing onto the players. All of it was about a salary cap, said Fair. So, we get to 1994, and basically the situation is the owners are saying, we're going to beat you into the ground. You're all just baseball players, you make too much money, and so we are going to get to the end of the season, and we are going to impose our terms and conditions. That was something we could not allow to happen. So both sides buckled down. On August 1st, the owners withheld a required $7.8 million payment from the players' pension and benefit plans. The players set a date of August 12th to strike, expecting the owners to blink first. What they didn't expect, however, was the fact that, aside from Reds owner Marge Schott and the Orioles' Peter Angelos, the owners were in this for the long haul, ready to go not only the remainder of 1994, but all of 1995 without an MLB season. On August 31st, federal mediators were unable to make progress in ending the strike. On September 14th, Selig called off the rest of the 1994 season, including the World Series. It would be the first year without a fall classic since 1904. As for the players, the work stoppage could not have come at a worse time. At the time of the strike, Tony Gwynn of the Padres was batting .394 and might have had the chance to become the first player since Ted Williams to finish a season over .400. Matt Williams of the Giants was on pace to match Roger Maris's record 61 home runs with 47 games remaining in the season. The New York Yankees had held a 6.5-game lead over the Orioles in the AL East, but when the postseason was canceled, so too were 13-year veteran Don Mattingly's chances at a playoff debut. But perhaps the most heartbreaking casualty of the 94 strike came from north of the border, where the Montreal Expos were in the middle of the best season in franchise history. Their record of 74-40 was the best in baseball, and many considered the Expos to be World Series contenders, despite their only having appeared in the playoffs once before in 1981. the cancellation not only denied the Expos their chance at glory, but it may have also been the final nail in the coffin for Major League Baseball in Montreal. After 10 years of declining attendance numbers, the Expos finally jumped ship in 2004, rebranding themselves as the Washington Nationals. Mariner star Ken Griffey Jr., whose 40 home runs led the American League at the time of the strike, summed it up best. "We picked a bad season to have a good year." As autumn gave way to winter, relations between the players and the owners were growing similarly frigid. In January of 1995, Congress got involved, introducing five bills aimed at ending the strike. On January 26th, both sides were ordered by President Clinton to reach an agreement by February 6th. But that deadline, too, came and went, with no deal in sight. Things came to a head that March, when the owners brought in replacement players to begin spring training. This move had major consequences. Ontario Labor Code prohibited the use of replacement players, meaning that the Blue Jays would be unable to play home games in Toronto. Sound familiar? Tigers manager Sparky Anderson refused to coach a team made up of scabs, and was put on an involuntary leave of absence as a result. To their credit, the Baltimore Orioles refused to begin the season with replacement players, although that decision was largely due to their concern about Cal Ripken's ongoing consecutive game streak. It was becoming increasingly clear that something was going to have to give. Then, just when it seemed all hope was lost, in stepped a woman from the Bronx. As the youngest judge in the Southern District of New York, Sonia Sotomayor had grown up in a housing project only a few miles from Yankee Stadium. In her career on the court, she had developed a reputation as a brisk jurist who wasn't afraid to take on powerful interest groups. So, when the National Labor Relations Board filed a complaint against the owners for unfair practices, it fell to Sotomayor to decide on the future of baseball. Over the course of the two-hour hearing, Sotomayor presided as both the Players Association and the owners made their respective cases. She grilled both sides thoroughly before stepping back to make a ruling. After only 15 minutes of deliberation, Sotomayor ruled in favor of the players, issuing an injunction against the owners that required them to restore free agency and arbitration. The players agreed to return to work on April 2nd. Baseball was back. 14 years later, Sonia Sotomayor was appointed as a justice for the United States Supreme Court. When he introduced her as the nominee, then-President Barack Obama noted her role in ending the crisis. Some say Judge Sotomayor saved baseball. As the 2021 season gets underway, the memories of last year's uncertainty are still fresh in baseball fans' minds. But we should remember the lessons of 1994 as well, because after this season, Major League Baseball may be staring down the barrel of yet another labor dispute, one that could potentially put the 2022 season in jeopardy. And while I'm not going to delve into the gritty details here, I've left some links in the description to help anyone who might be interested brush up on the facts of the matter. As always, please remember to like and subscribe, and leave some predictions for the 2021 season in the comments. I'd love to see what you guys think. And with that, there's only one thing left to say.